Sadabhinavapurvantam Vidyatirthagurum bhaje Akhilanandasandai Manognyamukhapankajam Jagadgurum jagatpujyam Vidyatirthamaham shraye Vidyate hridaya grantir drishte yasmin iti shrutihi jagau paravaram shantantam vidyatirthamashraye natatyananarangehi yasya sakshat saraswati Natarthi shamane dakshantam vidyatirthamashraye Vatamulam parityajya shringadrau nivasanhiyaha Tattvam bodhayate bhaktan dakshinasyantamashraye Vishayasham parityajya vairagyam paramam shritaha munayoyat kripa bhajastam vidyatirthamashraye dhyava bhumihi janayan devayeka iti shrutihi yanvarnayati sarveshantam vidyatirthamashraye tire tunga tatinya yastatvam sheshyan prabodhayan aste deshikharajantam vidyatirtham samashraye rithama purvam shrutiryastu yatavadava bodhayan shishyan dharma pathasaktan kurute tamaham shraye vidyatirthamashraye dakshinasyantamashraye. Vivekinam mahapragnyam dhairyau daryakshamanidhim sadabhinavapurvantam vidyatirthagurum bhaje advaita vidyarasikaya namaha anukampasaritpataye namaha atimanushacharitraya namaha amritopamabhashanaya namaha anekamathanirmatre namaha anekadarshanamarmavide namaha annapurna pratishthatre namaha sannutesha padambujaya namaha ahanta mamatahinaya namaha agajapati bhaktimate namaha agamartha parignatre namaha ashritakhila rakshakaya namaha ashapasha samuchetre namaha apannarti vinashakaya namaha iha virahita swantaya namaha ibhavaktra supujakaya namaha indumauli padadhyayine namaha iha mutrartha nisprahaya namaha karma karma vibhagajnaya namaha kirtaniya gunojvalaya namaha kamita shesha phaladaya namaha komalaswanta sanyutaya namaha kalatyadi parishkartre namaha kamakrodha vivarjitaya namaha karabjavilasaddandaya namaha kashayambara samvritaya namaha gurupadambujadhyayine namaha gananiya gunojvalaya namaha chittanairmalyasandayine namaha chintalesha vivarjitaya namaha ತೀರ್ಥರಾಜ ಕೃತಸ್ನಾನಾಯ ನಮಃ ತೀರ್ಥೀಕೃತ ಧರಾತಲಾಯ ನಮಃ ತುಷಾರಾಚಲ ಸಂಚಾರಿಣೇ ನಮಃ ತುಂಗಾಸ್ನಾನ ಸಮುತ್ಸುಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ದಕ್ಷಿಣಾಸ್ಯ ಪದಧ್ಯಾಯಿನೇ ನಮಃ ದಕ್ಷಿಣಾಂನಾಯ ಪೀಠಪಾಯ ನಮಃ ದಾಕ್ಷಿಣ್ಯನಿಲಯ ಸ್ವಾಂತಾಯ ನಮಃ ದಾಂತ್ಯಾದಿ ಪರಿಶೋಭಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಧರ್ಮಾಧರ್ಮ ವಿಭಾಗಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ ಧ್ಯಾನ ನಿರ್ಧೂತ ಕಲ್ಮಷಾಯ ನಮಃ ಧರ್ಮ ಪ್ರಚಾರ ನಿರತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಧಿಕ್ಕೃತಾಖಿಲ ದುರ್ಮತಾಯ ನಮಃ ನತಲೋಕ ಸಮುದ್ಧರ್ತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ ನಿಯಮಾಚರಣೋತ್ಸುಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ನ್ಯಾಯಮಾರ್ಗಾನುಸಾರಿಣೇ ನಮಃ ನ್ಯಾಯಾದಿನಯಕೋವಿದಾಯ ನಮಃ ನಿಗಮಾಗಮತತ್ವಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ ನಿತ್ಯಸಂತುಷ್ಟಮಾನಸಾಯ ನಮಃ ನಿಷ್ಕಳಂಕಸುಚಾರಿತ್ರಾಯ ನಮಃ ನೀತಿತತ್ವಸುಬೋಧಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ಪಾರಾವಾರಾತಿಗಂಭೀರಾಯ ನಮಃ ಪ್ರಾಣಾಯಾಮಪರಾಯಣಾಯ ನಮಃ ಪುರ್ಯಾದಿಕ್ಷೇತ್ರಯಾತ್ರಾಕೃತೇ ನಮಃ ಪುರಾಣಾಗಮತತ್ವವಿದೇ ನಮಃ ಪಾಲಿತಾಶೇಷಭಕ್ತೌಘಾಯ ನಮಃ ಪಿಂಗಳಾಬ್ಧಸಮುದ್ಭವಾಯ ನಮಃ ಬಹುಶಿಷ್ಯಸಮಾಯುಕ್ತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಬಹುಭಾಷಾವಿಶಾರದಾಯ ನಮಃ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮತತ್ವಾನುಸಂಧಾತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮವಿದ್ಯೋಪದೇಶಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ಭಕ್ತಹಾರ್ದತಮೋಭೇತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ ಭಿಕ್ಷುಕೋತ್ತಮರೂಪಧೃತೇ ನಮಃ ಭೇದವಾದೀಭಪಂಚಾಸ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ ಭುಕ್ತಿಮುಕ್ತಿಪ್ರದಾಯಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ಭಯಶೋಕಾದಿರಹಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಭವಭೀತಿನಿವಾರಣಾಯ ನಮಃ ಮಹಾವಾಕ್ಯವಿವೇಕಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ ಮಹಾಮಹಿಮಸಂಯುತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಮಹಾಪ್ರಜ್ಞಾಸಮಾಯುಕ್ತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಮಾತ್ಸರ್ಯಾದಿವಿವರ್ಜಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಮಧುರಾಲಾಪಚತುರಾಯ ನಮಃ ಮತಿನಿರ್ಜಿತಗೀಷ್ಪತಯೇ ನಮಃ ಮೋದಿತಾಖಿಲಭಕ್ತಾಲಯೇ ನಮಃ ಮರ್ಯಾದಾಪರಿಪಾಲಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ಯೋಗಿವಂದ್ಯಪದಾಂಭೋಜಾಯ ನಮಃ ಯೋಗಮಾರ್ಗವಿಶಾರದಾಯ ನಮಃ ರಾಜಾಧಿರಾಜಸಂಪೂಜ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ ರಾಗದ್ವೇಷವಿವರ್ಜಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ ರುದ್ರಾಕ್ಷಭೂಷಿತಗ್ರೀವಾಯ ನಮಃ ರುದ್ರಾರಾಧನತತ್ಪರಾಯ ನಮಃ ವಶೀಕೃತೇಂದ್ರಿಯಗ್ರಾಮಾಯ ನಮಃ ವಾಗ್ದೇವೀಸಮುಪಾಸಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ವಿದ್ಯಾರಣ್ಯಸಮಪ್ರಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ ವಿದ್ಯಾವಿನಯಶೋಭಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ ವೇದಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಪರಿತ್ರಾತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ ವಾದಿಮತ್ತೇಭಕೇಸರಿಣೇ ನಮಃ ವಿದಿತಾಖಿಲಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಾರ್ಥಾಯ ನಮಃ ವೀತರಾಗಜನಸ್ತುತಾಯ ನಮಃ ವ್ಯಾಖ್ಯಾಸಿಂಹಾಸನಾಧೀಶಾಯ ನಮಃ ವ್ಯಾಸಸೂತ್ರಾರ್ಥತತ್ವವಿದೇ ನಮಃ ಶಾರದಾಪೂಜನಾಸಕ್ತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶಾರದೇಂದುಸಮದ್ಯುತಯೇ ನಮಃ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರತಾತ್ಪರ್ಯಸಂವೇದಿನೇ ನಮಃ ಶಾರದಾಪೀಠನಾಯಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯಸಂಸೇವಿನೇ ನಮಃ ಶಂಕಾದ್ರಿಭಿದುರೋಪಮಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶಮಿತಾಖಿಲಸಂತಾಪಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶಮಾದಿಸುಗುಣಾಲಯಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶ್ರೀವಿದ್ಯಾಜಪನಿಷ್ಣಾತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶ್ರೀಚಕ್ರಾರ್ಚನತತ್ಪರಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶ್ರೀಶೇಷಭೇದರಹಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಶ್ರೀನೃಸಿಂಹಪದಾರ್ಚಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ಸಂಚಾರಪೂತಧರಣಯೇ ನಮಃ ಸಂಸಾರಾರ್ಣವನಾವಿಕಾಯ ನಮಃ ಸತ್ಯಾದಿಧರ್ಮನಿರತಾಯ ನಮಃ ಸರ್ವಭೂತದಯಾಪರಾಯ ನಮಃ ಅಜ್ಞಾನಧ್ವಾಂತಮಾರ್ತಂಡಾಯ ನಮಃ ವಿದ್ಯಾತೀರ್ಥ ಜಗದ್ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ.
ಮಾಲಾಸುಧಾಕುಂಭವಿಬೋಧಮುದ್ರಾಂ ವಿದ್ಯಾವಿರಾಜತ್ಕರವಾರಿಜಾತಾಂ ಅಪಾರಕಾರುಣ್ಯಸುಧಾಂಬುರಾಶಿಂ ಶ್ರೀ ಶಾರದಾಂಬಾಂ ಪ್ರಣತೋಸ್ಮಿ ನಿತ್ಯಂ. ಶಂಕಾರೂಪೇಣ ಮರ್ಚಿತ್ತಂ ಅಂಕೀಕೃತಮಭೂದ್ಯಯ ಕಿಂಕರೀಯಸ್ಸ ಸಾಮಾಯ ಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯಮಾಶ್ರಯೇ ಪ್ರಹ್ಲಾದವರದೋ ದೇವೋ ಯೋ ನೃಸಂಹಃ ಪರೋ ಹರಿಃ ನೃಸಿಂಹೋಪಾಶಕಂ ನಿತ್ಯಂ ತಂ ನೃಸಿಂಹ ಗುರುಂ ಭಜೇ ಶ್ರೀ ಸಚ್ಚಿದಾನಂದ ಶಿವಾ ಅಭಿನವ್ಯ ನೃಸಿಂಹ ಭಾರತ್ಯಪಿತಾನ್ಯತೀಂದ್ರಾನ್ ವಿದ್ಯಾನಿತೀನ್ ಮಂತ್ರನಿತೀನ್ ಸದಾತ್ಮನಿಷ್ಠಾನ್ ಭಜೇ ಮಾನವ ಶಂಭುರೂಪಾನ್ ಸದಾತ್ಮಜ್ಞಾನನಿರತಂ ವಿಷಯೇಭ್ಯ ಪರಾನ್ಮುಖಂ ನೌಮಿ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರೇಷು ನಿಷ್ಣಾತಂ ಚಂದ್ರಶೇಖರ ಭಾರತೀ ವಿವೇಕಿನಂ ಮಹಾಪ್ರಜ್ಞಂ ಧೈರ್ಯೋದಾರಕ್ಷಮಾನಿತಿಂ ಸದಾ ಅಭಿನವಪೂರ್ವಂ ತಂ ವಿದ್ಯಾತೀರ್ಥಗುರುಂ ಭಜೇ ಅಜ್ಞಾನಾಂ ಜಾಹ್ನವೀತೀರ್ಥಂ ವಿದ್ಯಾತೀರ್ಥಂ ವಿವೇಕಿನಾಂ ಸರ್ವೇಷಾಂ ಸುಖತಂ ತೀರ್ಥಂ ಭಾರತೀತೀರ್ಥಮಾಶ್ರಯೇ ವಿದ್ಯಾವಿನಯಸಂಪನ್ನಂ ವೀತರಾಗಂ ವಿವೇಕಿನಂ ವಂದೇ ವೇದಾಂತತತ್ವಜ್ಞಂ ವಿದುಶೇಖರ ಭಾರತೀ. I pray to the lotus feet of Jyeshta Mahasannidanam, Jagadguru Srimad Abhinava Vidyatirtha Mahaswamigal, our revered Mahasannidanam, Jagadguru Sri Sri Bharati Tirtha Mahaswamigal, and our revered Sannidanam, Jagadguru Sri Sri Vidushekara Bharati Mahaswamigal. May them reside in the hearts of all of us and bless us, and may their divine thoughts guide us in this evening to come out as the truth and the value of this great throne of transcendental wisdom. I place my head at the lotus feet of the Acharyals before I proceed to speak in this evening. Dear devotees, we are into the fifth lecture today, and today and tomorrow it would be our blessings and delight to share about our Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, Jagadguru Srimad Abhinava Vidyatirtha Mahaswamigal. In the first lecture we had a divine opportunity to speak about Bhagavad Pada Shankara. In the second lecture, about the 10th, 11th and the 12th Acharyal, with specific reference to Saint Vidyaranya Maharaj. And in the third lecture, our 25th Acharyal, then our 32nd Acharyal and the 33rd Acharyal. And in the fourth lecture, about Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal. So in that series, today and tomorrow, we are very delighted to present whatever little we know about our Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam. When I spoke last time in delight narrating the incidents from the life history of Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal, I did say that we need to do a saptaham. That's the kind of material and literature available for us to speak about that great Jivan Muktha. But after getting into the details, trying to know about our Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, it is certainly possible that we can do a complete navaham on Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam. That's the kind of wealth of materials we have about our guru, which we will now try to compress in two speeches outlining the broad ideas. Every speech which we have delivered, we have traced it to the authors who have contributed it. In all the earlier four lectures, it has been a combination of several authors and several devotees' experiences which found part in the various books and texts which we relied it as the source. But when it comes to Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, the one and only source which we have relied upon to share our views in the next 2 days is from the book released last year, a compendium of earlier collections and huge new value add, a compendium released on the centenary occasion of our Jyeshta Maha Sannidanam last year by Maha Sannidanam, a compilation of by Sri Umeshji. Entire lecture will only focus from that book, nothing else. There is no need to go anywhere outside. In fact, earlier part of the life history of Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam, we also understand, has been contributed and handed over to Sri Umeshji by one Subratnam Iyer. He was the one who has done an interview of Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam's father of his early days. But for that, rest of the text has been completely compiled by him. In fact, before I proceed to speak, in utter gratitude and sincerity, I should say this. Last year, immediately after the release of this book, one of our devotees called me and said that Sri Umeshji wants to hand over this book to you. I have got this book. I'll come and meet you tomorrow and give it. So when he came and delivered this book, I don't know, the moment I touched this book and started to flip through the pages, first time the idea came that why don't we pray to Acharyal and deliver a series of lectures on our Acharyal Parampari. This is the connecting point, to be very precise. This thought never came before that. So this book, when it landed into a disciple's hands, triggered him to aspire that we should talk about the holy parampara of our mutt. This is the background in which these speeches have been running through in these few months. And therefore, we are going to talk about two important personalities in the next 2 days. The greatness of our Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam. The first lecture, today's lecture, will be from his day of avataram and how he attained Jivan Muktha. First lecture will cover that. And the second lecture tomorrow, in spite of being a Jivan Muktha is one who has attained enlightenment in the human body and who has no work and no purpose to serve other than waiting to throw his mortal coil as destined by fate. He has no other purpose. But because he was brought into this peetam, and as a peetadhipati, he had to run it for 55 long years, from the 18th year to the 73rd year, he had done this with utter dispassion and with the greatest love. You can use the expression Catholicity. That's the expression we can use in defining our Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam. So tomorrow's talk will cover the experience, how he is. Today it will be about Jivan Muktha, and tomorrow it will be how Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam remained yet a multifaceted personality. And that's how this book is coined as Multifaceted Jivan Muktha. That's the reason. He was an administrator. He was a leader. He had so much passion for the nation, passion to animals, passion to children, passion to his devotees. Nothing is left out in the spectrum, which we will see tomorrow. With this introduction, let me attempt to speak whatever little I have gained out of this book to share as to how Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam from his birth became a Jivan Muktha. I should tell you, dear devotees, compared to the rest of the lectures, this particular lecture is likely to be slightly terse because we are going to share about how did Shiva appear before him and what did Shiva teach him? What is Kundalini Yoga? What is Savikalpa Samadhi? What is Nirvikalpa Samadhi? How did he attain bliss? So it may be slightly terse and slightly abstract, but someone has attained it. That attainment is shared and experienced by someone who has authored this book. So I'm nobody near them to even utter words of wisdom from that. But yet, I've taken this small, humble attempt to share whatever little knowledge we have grasped out of this book to share with you with delight. It's a delight to share this experience without a doubt, but I only pray once again that words, thoughts, and expressions as found should flow through this body through sheer grace and nothing else. Otherwise, the task cannot be completed. Jyeshta Maha Sannidanam was born on 13th November 1917, 101 years back, to Sri Rama Shastrihal and Venkata Lakshanamma. Three instances bring out what he was within the first 12 years. His friends go out and they all eat in somebody's house. He was absolutely neutral to the taste of the food. He never expressed any emotions as to whether it was tasting hard or tasting sweet. Rest of the children who ate had to panic and go in search of jaggery. It was so chilly. He was just remaining equipoised. So the rest of the children wanted to test him. He said, "You appear to be taking everything lightly." "Yes," he said, I'm neutral to it. Food is something which God gives us prasadam, so I'm taking it." Is it so? "Come on, eat this handful of chilies." They dumped a packet full of chilies when he was 11 years old. Quietly ate one after the other, without any murmur, completed the whole stuff and remained what he was earlier. And said that neither pain nor pleasure affects me. It's the first incidence which is reported in the book. The second incident is, he had a small crystal idol of Mahaganapati. He goes to his mother and says, "Can you give me something which I can offer as Naivedyam?" Mother struggles, finds there is nothing available to give it to him for offerings to the God. He finds the difficulty in the face of his mother and says, "Just don't bother. After all, Lord Krishna has said in the Bhagavad Gita, it doesn't matter what you give. What it all matters is how you give." Takes a teaspoon of water and with utter devotion goes and offers it at the lips of Mahaganapati and says, "Please take it as my offering." And the third instance which is shared in the book is, his father, late Rama Shastrihal, was a teacher. And Srinivasan, as he was named prior to becoming a Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, was in the habit of teaching ever so many children. All his peers were taught by him. There was some misunderstanding. Father thought that Srinivasan has committed some blunder. And as a school teacher, 100 years back, took the cane and started hitting his right hand mercilessly. This caning was going on for some time. There was a tenant in that house by name Venkatraman who was an astrologer. He suddenly interfered and stopped this engagement and took the hand of Srinivasan to find out what sort of a hurt it had happened. And he finds, to his surprise, that the palm indicates that he will be in future a great renowned sannyasi. He shares this information to Rama Shastrihal. "Please bear one aspect in mind. Some point of time he'll become a sannyasi. You may have to offer respects to him. Do not beat him anymore." But Rama Shastri did not stop with it. He went and consulted his family astrologer, who confirmed that he shall become a sannyasi at some point of time. At 12 years, Srinivasan started to tell and share with his friends, "I would like to renounce life and become a sannyasi." When the friends asked him, "Why do you want to?" he gave two answers. I can be happy and I can be free from worries if I take to sannyas. That was the answer given by him at the age of 12. He went to his sister's house. He was born in a family of 5 children. He was the first male child, but the second child in the sequence. He had a sister by name Sita Lakshmi. So when he visited her house, he had a taste for ghee and he started to pour ghee and started to taste it in his mouth. His brother-in-law watched it and indicated to his wife, who was his sister, I think time has come for him that we should do the investiture of a Upanayanam on him. Because this is an indication, you normally offer ghee only at that point of time. Meanwhile, Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal conveys to Shikanta Sastrigal, I would like to now find out a successor, somebody whose horoscope is of this order. So Shrikanta Sastrigal comes to Bangalore and meets Venkatrama Sastrigal, who was the one who stopped that the engagement of a caning process. And he was asking him, do you know or have you come across any young boy, a brahmachari, who has the horoscope of likely to become a sannyasi in the future? Venkatrama Sastrigal says, yes, I have a boy and his horoscope. Both are available with me. Come and I'll show you. So he meets him. And Shikanta Sastrigal inquires, has Upanayanam been done? They say, no. Then he says, let's have it at Shingeri. So when he was born in 1917, he was done the Upanayanam on 4th May 1930 at Shingeri. This happened the 13th year of Acharyal. And as things would go, 5 days of functions got over. They all went to Narasimhavana to have the darshan of Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal. And the parents were about to leave. And the book beautifully narrates the interview conducted by Jagadguru Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal on Jyeshta Mahasannidhi. That was an actual interview, a question. So he was asking him, you are a brahmachari, you are in the school. He was in the 8th class or so. You are now in the school, it's time for you to go back and join school and start studying. Srinivasan replied, no, I don't want to study in school. And he was inquiring, what were you studying so far? Questions were asked on history. Questions were asked on geography. And finally, a question was asked, what is the value or moral you have learnt in your school? To which Srinivasan replied, be in the company of good and eschew evil associations. That triggered the process of thinking. And Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal consults Shikanta Sastrigal and conveys, are you interested to be in Shingeri? The boy jumps with the idea, yes, I would love to do. Then you be in Shingeri. And that's it. He went for the Upanayanam and stayed in Shingeri. And this happened in May 1930. Those days, in fact, Bhashya Swamigal narrates it in the one of the volumes, the 3 volumes of Guru Kripa Valasam. Acharyal, Bhashya Swamigal, who was Vaidyanatha Sastrigal earlier, and a batch of young brahmacharis used to walk from Narasimhavana to Kalabhairava temple every day. And they will play literally an andadi, which we are very familiar with in our TV television channels, with shlokas and mantras and so many things. Then every day, a topic will be taken up for discussion. This book narrates several such topics and several spectrum, a wide spectrum, wide-ranging subjects come up for discussion with these brahmacharis, with aid of their teacher, Vaidyanatha Shastri. One of the discussions which needs to be highlighted was about Dakshinamurti. So, Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamigal asked a pertinent question. When we imagine the deity Dakshinamurti, what comes to our mind immediately is the Chinmudra. If it's just showing, signifying the fact that Jivatma and Paramatma can. It's nothing but they can unite at a point, provided you dispense with your three gunas out. This is something which is familiar and well known. So he didn't ask that question. He asked a question. Can you see what has been borne by Dakshinamurti in the rest of his three hands? A book, a snake, and a fireball. And asked a question, what do they actually signify? To which Vaidyanatha Shastri had replied, the book is for knowledge. Snake is for knowledge, and the fireball is to indicate an all-pervasiveness. And he justified it by saying, a book has several pages, but when you integrate it, it forms into one book, and therefore it signifies Advaita. A snake, in our Upanishad, the snake and rope philosophy comes for identification. We are not, the illusion mistakes us a snake to be a rope, and we finally identify that no rope exists. And therefore, it signifies knowledge. And fire is something which pervades all over, and therefore, it pervades all over the universe to say that this is all one and the same. Acharyal did not approve it. He looked at Srinivasan and said, do you have anything to say? And Srinivasan replied, the book is for knowledge. Snake is for experience, reasoning. And the fireball is for experience. And justified it in the following way. The book signifies content of knowledge. So one has to acquire knowledge through those texts and scriptures. But acquiring bookish knowledge doesn't give you emancipation. So book gives you knowledge. But it is the snake which gives you the power to reason what you have read. The illusion between a snake and a rope gets distinguished through nothing but the power of reasoning. And when it comes to the fireball, Srinivasan explains, after all, has not Lord Krishna said in the Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, once you get enlightenment, enlightenment is a process of acquiring self-knowledge, a point at which all your karmas and vasanas get burnt once and for all into ashes. This is the power of fire, and therefore, fireball signifies experience. Acharyal was so thrilled. And he said to Srikantha Shastri, I think he is the brahmachari who should succeed me. And does three things. First, prays to his guru, the 33rd Acharyal of this Pedam, Sri Sachidananda Shiva Abhinava Nisama Bharati Mahaswamigal. Prays to Lord Chandramouli Swara very loudly as and when he performs the morning puja and goes to the Sharada temple and also prays to Matha Sharada that show me the Sishya if he is the one. And they finalize finally that Srinivasan will be the next Ube Adhikari of this Peetam, the 35th Acharyal of this Peetam. So it was decided that he will adorn the throne subsequent to Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal. What did happen? On the day, just the penultimate day of sannyasa, which happened on 22nd May 1931, three dates are important. 13th November 1917 was his Jananam. 4th May 1930 was his Upanayanam. And in just 1 year, 22nd May 1931, he is adopted into the Peetam when he was effectively 13 and a half years old, or you may call it as 14 years, whatever it may be, at that young, tender age. Before taking him into the Peetam, one interesting incident happened. All the four Brahmacharis were staying together with Vaidyanatha Shastrigal, who later became Bhashya Swamigal. He used to perform puja to Ambal, Vishnu and Shivan. And what was offered as a Naivedyam was taken as a sattvic food by these Brahmacharis. One day, Srinivasan got very high fever, uncontrollable fever. So when this was reported to Acharyal, Acharyal said, leave him alone. Only find out, and instructed Bhashya Swamigal, just find out what is he saying. And Srinivasan was just chanting Shivoham, 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 and nothing else. And after 2 days, he did inquire to Bhashya Swamigal, does Acharyal know? Because whenever our Sagapadigal falls sick, he used to send a Vibhuti Prasadam. He used to inquire, he has not come to me at all for the last 2 days. I don't know what is happening. Bhashya Swamigal, don't worry, he'll come. So 3 days gets over. One fine, it was a Ekadesi after that. Acharyal drops into his room and ensures all the attendants move away. Bhashya Swamigal, Acharyal, and Srinivasan, nobody else. The moment he saw Acharyal, Srinivasan fell just right at the feet of His Holiness. Bhashya Swamigal for a minute was taken aback, because it is not a practice or tradition of this mutt where a devotee goes and holds the feet of an Acharyal. He was for a minute stuck. Acharyal said, leave him. And asked him how he was. He said, I'm yet to recoup. Do not worry, it's all over. And he just blessed him by putting his holy hands on the head of Srinivasan. Bhashya Swamigal writes 3 things. He had the opportunity of a Nayana Dikshay for 1 year because he has been traveling to the Kalabhairava temple almost every day. Now he had both the Sparsa Dikshay and also, of course, Mantra Dikshay was not taken at that point of time. He gave a Sparsa Dikshay both through his divine hand and also by allowing him to place his head on a lotus feet. And he also writes, astrologers predicted that looking at the horoscope of Srinivasan, he may not survive or he may not live long. So Bhashya Swamigal writes a note that all this has happened to ensure those hurdles are compressed just with a mere 3-day fever and extricated once and for all. And so he allowed that to pass through without any medication and cleaned up. And it all happened on an Ekadesi day, which is very auspicious, which is normally the day where such an initiation happens, is what Bhashya Swamigal writes. So now Acharya is prepared. So on 21st, it happens on the 22nd sannyasam, 22nd, 21st night, Sharadambal appears in his dream. Invites him into his sanctum sanctorum, makes him sit on her lap, and says, O divine child, follow your guru henceforth. Kings and royal servants will pay obeisance to you. Do not lose yourself. Follow your guru. You will reign this Peetam with glory and kindness. I shall bless you for that. This happened on 21st night, the previous day. 22nd morning, he is taken into sannyasa. And 2 things happen. The moment he became a sannyasi, which is something which we had that spectacular events seen 3 years back when it happened to our Sannidanam, Jagadguru, Vidyashekhara Bharati Swamigal. It would have always remained spectacular at every point of time. Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamigal looks at the Sishya and says, come here, long live, come here. And Bhashya Swamigal writes, why did he say, come here, the long live? he destroys any symptoms or assumptions that his life has some trouble or peril because of the horoscopical predictions. It's all over. Call him, because the words of a Jagadguru is bound to fall true. Can never go wrong. So he said, come, long live. That's how he invites him into the ashrama. Then evening, they always go on a pallak throughout the Shingeri streets. So the golden pallak is ready and the silver pallak is ready. And Chandrasekhara Mahaswamigal, as usual, surprises Shikanta Shastri, says that, I will go and choose only the silver, ask my Sishya to occupy the golden pallak. It shocks Shikanta Shastri. He says, why? No, today is a day for me to renounce all this. Let me start it from today. So Shri Umeshji writes in the book, after a very long time, he inquired Jyeshta Maha Sannidanam, it was after all your first days of sannyasam, and suddenly you are asked to sit on this throne. How did you feel? Were you feeling reluctant? Were you feeling slightly awkward? Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam triumphantly smiles to reply to say, it's the command of my guru to go and sit there. Nothing else has entered into my mind on that day. Guru says, go and sit. I just sat on the throne. Nothing else mattered to me. So both the Acharyals on the 22nd evening steps into the shrine of Sharadamba. And Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamigal says to his Sishya, look here, we are entering into the fold of our mother. Trust her completely. Have no doubts about her. Grace, keep going. That's the message he gives as they step into the shrine of Sharadamba. And Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam narrates, when he came out of it, he saw a cobra. When he walked into Narasimhavana, he saw a cobra just in front of him. He was watching the cobra with delight, and the cobra was watching him with delight. That's exactly how they describe it. It's a vindication of the proven theory that one who is in the path of Advaita will not have any fear. Ahimsa is one of the qualities of an Advaitin. The Sanatana Dharma is not born out of Ahimsa. Ahimsa is just one of the ingredients of Sanatana Dharma. And it got displayed in that evening, which Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam says, I see it as a sign of auspiciousness. Then the whole story starts from there and thereon. That night, he retires to bed. That is 22nd May 1931. One full week, from 22nd May 1931 to 28th May 1931, 7 nights, he was graced with dreams where Shiva appeared and taught him yoga directly. And how did it happen? As Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam, because it's a whole day, he was 14 years old, you can understand what sort of process one has to undergo in Shingeri to become a sannyasi. Dead tired, just falls into sleep and suddenly feels he was in a place, ice-clad mountains. That's exactly the expression used in the book. And out comes a beautiful crystal Shivalinga. And a non-stop overflowing of water on it. And Acharyal could visibly hear the chanting of Maharudram. He heard Rudram being chanted. It's ice-clad. But Jyeshta Maha Sannidhanam says, it was not cold or chill, it was pleasant. And he was there. And from and out of that Shivalinga came out Lord Shiva. One face, two arms, radiant white, matted hair, and just looks at Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam for the first time. Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam says, the moment Shiva saw him, he started to chant Om voluntarily. No efforts, no initiation. The sight of Shiva made him to chant Om voluntarily. And he says two things about it. For one long year, he was consciously practicing the chanting of Om. Beyond that, it just reminded him as part of his daily routine. 24/7, he was in that bliss of chanting Om. One direct divine sight of Lord Shiva. Then Lord Shiva, as he sees Mahasannidhanam, finds a deer skin being placed and says, and directs Mahasannidhanam, Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, sit on that. And he takes a tiger skin. And the whole 7 nights, there is a direct communication in the form of first teaching Pranayama, hundreds of asanas, hundreds, and also a few kriyas. In fact, when she Umeshji interviews and asks, did Shiva teach you any of the asanas which is not there in the textbook or known to the world? He said, yes, he has indeed taught me 6 such asanas which is not in practice. And he said, even though he taught me hundreds of asanas, he made it very clear, some are for practice, some are for only knowledge. Even at the time of displaying each of the asanas and explain, oh, what a grace it was to see Shiva doing the yoga. And he said, I will demonstrate one asana for you, which is not in the standard books. Close the door, puts his upper garment down and takes to a position where the book describes, it's as Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam looked as though he was made out of complete elastic rubber with no bones to it. That's the kind of flexibility he could marshal through his efforts. He was stunned. And Acharyal explains, it took me 5 times to reach this perfection. When I did it at the first time, I could do it, but I couldn't release myself. So I recalled what Lord Shiva taught me. That's the point. That's the point that this particular instance seeks to show. He was able to, it's not as though he was dreaming and some yoga happened and the dream, the moment he woke up, the dream left. No. When he got caught at the first instance, he recalled how Shiva taught him. He was able to see exactly, visibly what is happening. And he then untied himself slowly. That's exactly what he says. Years after, decades after, the book says, even after several decades, he was able to recall whatever asana he wanted as to how Shiva taught him. Three things happened in the course of these 7 nights. One, the chanting of Om, which was voluntary, which the author explains, uninterrupted and graceful. The chanting of Om remained with him thereafter and forever. And Acharyal says, the second experience he gained out of the 7 consecutive nights is, shell your ego once and for all. That's the second moral or divine direction he was able to perceive. Shell your ego henceforth. And the third, the author writes, how do we believe dreams? And he therefore cites an incident. In Mahabharata, when there was a challenge that Jayadratha has to be killed by the evening of tomorrow, then Arjuna had to somehow ensure that he is able to put the Pasupata Hastra. And he forgot that mantram, even though he acquired it and he forgot it. When Arjuna went to sleep that night, he got a dream. And Krishna took Arjuna on an aerial journey to Shivaloka. That's what Mahabharata says. He goes to the Shivaloka and they eulogize the greatness of Shiva and says, this mantram has to be taught again to Arjuna to kill Jayadratha. A young boy comes out of Shiva and displays what is the mantra and how this should be spoken and shot. And this is how Arjuna gains back the knowledge on Pasupatastra. Gods do communicate through dreams. Not that every dream we get or seeing something good in the dream becomes or matures into such a reality that you require divine grace. It doesn't happen just like that. So, these seven meetings made Acharyal at the age of 14 to be an expert in Yoga Shastra. In fact, he writes in the last few pages of that chapter about Kriyas, which I don't want to be narrating each one of them. One of them is the Skechara Mudra, where you elongate your tongue, put it back, and place it, and you will start receiving the divine nectar, which he did receive. He says, I received it. So, several combinations, several permutations, several yogas taught one after the other in delight. Everything was displayed by him and he was made to do it. That's exactly how this perfect teacher-taught relationship. So, Acharyal, at the age of 14, became a yogi, an expert in yoga. Now, he goes to the next stage of becoming a karma yogi. And how does this happen? One day, he was in penance. And when Umeshji enters to meet him, tears come out of his eyes. And he was still so equipoised and was in great moments of delight. When he inquired, what is all this about? Acharyal says, I just remember the day where he initiated me into the Narasimha Mantra and made me into a Karma Yogi. How did this happen? Acharyal calls, the Guru calls his Shishya, places his divine hand on him and starts the Dhyana Sloka on Narasimha. The moment he touches his head, Shishya is able to materialize Narasimha in his heart. That's exactly what the book says. The Lord, as portrayed in the Dhyana Sloka, appears in his heart. And when Guru kept placing his holy hand, divine hand on the holy head of his Shishya, the Shishya starts performing the Pancha Upachara Puja, which all we do, whoever has taken Mantropadesam knows, starting from Gandham, Pushpam, Dupam, Deepam, Nevedyam, and Sarupacharam. Acharyal says, I took my own time in putting the sandalwood with delight on Narasimha. I took my time in showing the lamp and the Dupam. And I dreamt of having a huge plate studded with gems, kept the best of food for the Lord, and I started to give it slowly to the Lord, and I could visualize and experience the Lord masticating it in his mouth. That's exactly what the book says. He keeps giving food, one morsel after the other, and the Lord chews it in delight. And the senior guru waits. It doesn't disturb him. He says, a clear half an hour even would have passed. Never mind, never mind. The senior guru was waiting. Then he puts it for the second time. As he places the hand on Acharyal, he takes it back immediately and starts worshipping his Sishya with absolute, absolute obedience and reverence. Sishya remains intact. He doesn't know why this is happening. Puts the hand and continues to complete the course for the third time and takes it out. And then narrates that when I did the second time, Lord Narasimha took over you and I didn't see you. I saw only the deity in front of me. It got substituted. And therefore I offered my prayers to Narasimha. I didn't see any difference between you. You were not there. And you got restored a little later. And I therefore completed the cycle. And the guru therefore said, henceforth, Narasimha is your friend, philosopher and guide. And Acharyal writes, how did he experience it? He says, when I bathe, I got the experience as though Narasimha is bathing in me, through me. When I ate, I found that it is Narasimha which is masticating the food. When I read a book, I felt Narasimha is staying as my inner voice and listening to the whole content. And I kept walking. I found Narasimha to be my companion, walking along with me for a stroll. The words used in the book, for a stroll. So, Karma Yogi is not just repeating the word Karma Yogi and say that we'll all do our Jewar's karma. We keep saying all these things so easily and casually in our daily routines. A Karma Yogi is one who lives by rote from dawn to dusk. 24/7, Smarana is about the Lord. And therefore, he says, everything I did, after which Narasimha became my companion. See, all of us without fail would have seen two photographs of Jyeshta Maha Sannidanam with Narasimha. One photo where he speaks to the Lord. And the other photo, the Lord speaking to him and he's listening to it. It's a very, all of us would have seen it. All of us would have seen it. Now you relate this initiation and look at the photo next time. And how it would have been. He did not worship an idol. He did not worship a stone. He was talking to his companion. And his companion was talking to him. You can see that photo from that perspective. So, from yoga, he became a karma yogi. That's the second transformation. Now the third transformation. Before we venture, as I said, because it's slightly terse, let me also just narrate. If you read the book, it has several parables, several instances, several divine talks on abstract topics on Advaita. He cites something interesting from Ramayana. A question is asked, what do you do when your father says you should do something? And your mother says you should do to the opposite. Whom should you listen to? Because disobeying any one of them is still disobeying. It's not dharma. So this challenge came to Rama. Dasharatha said, I have given two boons to Kaikeyi. She has exercised her boons. You go to the forest. So that's a command of a father. When he goes to Kaushalya, Kaushalya says, I can't allow this to happen. You better serve me. Whether you serve the kingdom or not, it's immaterial. You can better serve me. And somebody who is by serving his mother has become a prajapati and part of the creation. You will be such a virtuous person in times to come. You better be with me and serve. So how do you reconcile both? Rama says, there are two difficulties in obliging your request. One, Dasharatha is not just a father. He is also a king. A king's command binds all his subjects. You may be my mother, but you are still a subject of Ayodhya. Therefore, the king's command should prevail first. In terms, if there is a conflict of dharmas in practice, you should prioritize. So I will have to prioritize in favor of King Dasharatha. And two, I can oblige your request, but it will land up in doing or breaching the promise given by me to my father and a breach of his divine command. Both of us will be committing mistakes mutually against each other. Should we do that, or can you sacrifice your request? And he conquers the heart of Kaushalya and says, you can depart. Like this, each and every aspect, minute aspects of these stories, he brings it out beautifully and brings out the true valid dimensions. It's all there in that book. Now let's get back. Now, yoga is over. Karma yoga is over. Now he goes to the third stage. What is the third stage? His guru says, contemplate on yourself. All right, how do you do it? He puts it on as a four-stage process. First stage, when you walk anywhere, imagine yourselves to be a wave in the huge ocean, so that you don't feel individualistic. You will never feel individualistic. You will be connected to the whole universe as though it's an ocean, and you are just a wave in that ocean. Keep doing that in your mind constantly. Second, when you talk, imagine this in your mind, that you are a wave in the ocean. Third, when you lie down, when you go to sleep, or no, when you sit in a posture, imagine this whole world to be a string of consciousness in which you remain an imperishable gem attached to it, not moving anywhere. And lastly, when you go to sleep, imagine yourself as though you are slowly sinking into your ocean nicely as part of that ocean. So he's asked to train his mind on four things. When he walks, when he talks, when he sits, and when he sleeps. See, the whole narration in this book, at least according to my perception, look at the process the Acharyals have to undergo before they become Jivan Muktas. It's not an easy task. See, we go there and we see them in human form and we start talking to them as human beings. See what is happening in the background. And this is the closest, most proximate analysis of truth. And why do we say it is truth? Because whatever is narrated in this book by Sri Umeshji has been authenticated by Maha Sannidanam, as every sentence, every instance reported is truth. When he released the book Yoga and Enlightenment, and also when he released this book, if you read the Sri Mukham of Yoga and Enlightenment, because all this is figuring only in that book, there is a Sri Mukham by Maha Sannidanam, authenticating whatever has been narrated is truth and nothing but the truth. So, no stories, no cock and bull stories. And I will, when I narrate a little further, you will know all the Acharyals have experienced it in some form or the other, all these things, without fail. This Pitam believes in spending its time only on Brahma Vidya, only in Yoga Shastra, only in Advaita Tattva and Shastra Vicharam. Nothing else. Everything else is temporary and illusory as you go and speak to them. The foundational stones are only these four pillars. Now, he is asked to do these four. Then Sishya raises a doubt. He says, if I start practicing this, will it not hurt my task as a karma yogi? Because you have taught me that I should meditate on Narasimha for whatever I do. When I talk, walk, eat, I should think of Narasimha. Now you say you think of a wave. What should I do? Genuine question. And the teacher says, give up your karma yoga. You now practice this. That's enough. That's the direct instruction. Then he puts a small rider. I have so much taste and love to do a meditation on Charadambal whenever I go. Should I give it up? Then the guru gives a concession. Whenever you want to do prayers on Charadambal, please feel free to do. Rest of the time, you should do only these four. And how does he verify it? One fine day, when Sishya meets the guru, he asked a question. Where are you coming from? I'm coming from Charadambal's temple. You would have crossed the river. Yes. What did you see? I saw the river. Did you see anything else? Yes, of course I saw some fishes. What did you do before that? I was thinking I was a wave in the ocean. What did you do immediately after that? I was thinking that I was a wave in the ocean. But what did you do when you see the fish? I saw the fish. This should not happen once again. That's a clear caution. For a second, he discontinued thinking himself to be a wave in the ocean and saw a fish. Jagadguru asked, oh, so you want fish, you have assumed yourself and the fishes are different. Why did you do that? I don't want this to happen again. Utter caution. Jyeshta Mahanam says, it's a caution which I felt as a great insult to me in my pursuit. Imagine what a Pitathipati, what our gurus are actually doing in penance, in silence. All this is narrated, all this is stated for us to understand when we go and see them the next time, we should attach a lot of solemnity to what we do once. Non-stop, 24/7, they think what the guru wants them to do. So, he now goes to the third stage of thinking himself as a part of the wave, thinking himself as part of the jewel, and dissolving himself. In fact, Acharyal suggests to all of us, says, when you retire to bed, spend a few minutes and consciously erase the events that happened that day, and then go to sleep. After a few days of practice, you will realize how nice and enthralling it is. It's one advice which all of us can practice. Rest, none of us should attempt, because he says, tomorrow starts 8 o'clock, when you get out of the hall, you should not be thinking we are a wave walking into the ocean. He says, there's a clear initiation process. You don't attempt it all by your own. It requires the guidance of a guru and a monitoring by a guru. It's not something which you can easily practice on your own. But attempting to erase your memory and sleep, that is one concession he has given to Sishyas. You can attempt it ourselves. So this is the third stage. Now what happens as the fourth stage? He now gets inducted into meditation in divine forms. Hatha yoga, karma yoga, contemplation of the self, and now he moves to the fourth grade, meditation on divine forms. How does this happen? Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamigal one day calls Acharyal, how do you meditate? So Acharyal was narrating how I'll take the rosary, I'll sit in this posture. He explains the whole thing. Then he says, are you interested in doing meditation, deep meditation of divine forms? That was the question. Jyeshta Maha Sannidanam jumped. He said, yes, I want to do. Well, then I'll tell you how to do. You don't have to take your rosary and start the process that way. I'll give you a different. Here again, this should not be practiced all by ourselves. These are all things to understand the distance which each one of us have to travel in life and how many million births we have to take to go there. But these are all things which happens to our Pitadhipatis. That's the point which we should register at this stage. Now, he says, I will teach you how you will have to meditate in deep form. Prescribes two techniques. Concentrate your eyes at the brow level. You will get a tingling sensation. And Acharya explains why his guru taught him so. Why do you get the tingling sensation? He says, when there is a mosquito bite on your hand, will you not concentrate on that bite and ignore rest parts of the body? Therefore, tingling sensation takes you to that part and makes you disassociate with the rest parts of the body. Then, gives a detailed process of how to invite the devata into a meditative form. In the form of a disc. It's a big process. See, we'll put, as I said, you need to do a navaham if you have to understand everything. We'll have to share everything. But the quintessence needs to be put in an hour or hour and a half's time to understand what glorious Pitadhipatis God has gifted us in our lives. So that tingling sensation is one. Now, Senior Acharyal says, by doing this type of a deep meditation, you are assured of two things. You will slowly forget the sense over your body and the sense over the surroundings. That is the purpose of meditation. You should get over these two. And therefore, I'm putting you into this process. And the first two deities which Sishya tries to meditate upon is, one is Sharadambai, and the second one is Bala Tripurasundari. He feels greater delight and happiness in doing this meditation in this form. Goes back to his guru. What do I do next? He, in fact, if you see the whole series in that chapter, he is introduced to, especially the first three, Sharadambai, Bala Tripurasundari, and then Narasimha, which was always his companion, friend, philosopher, and guide. When he understands this to this extent, Acharya introduces him to the next stage. Says, he gives, in fact, Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam narrates it as an example, what he heard years back when he was a child. Somebody went to an eye doctor and sat before for an eye test. The doctor put over a glass frame and asked him to read. And he started to read even the last line perfectly. He said, I think this is the glass I need to wear, it's perfect. And the doctor said, I'm yet to put the glass, I put only the frame. So, but the truth of the matter is, if you believe, if you start concentrating on something, something indeed will appear. And Acharyal prescribes 2-3 important steps. This is how he portrays it beautifully. He says, all hearts are hearts where divinity resides, we should believe. We say Jiva. Divinity resides in our hearts. Divinity is invisible. But divinity is compassionate. It's ready to become visible, provided you are initiated into a mantra by your guru. See, all of us, many of us would have got initiated in mantras. This chapter is very important for us. We should understand what this mantra means to us by our guru. Jiva, which resides in our heart in an invisible form, the guru allows it to transpire as a visible form for our prayer. And how does he do? He initiates a mantra with a dhyana sloka. So, when you narrate the dhyana sloka with faith, what remained invisible in your heart will emerge visible in front of you. And said, now you meditate. Acharyal engages in deep meditation of Bala Tripurasundari and says, when he started to meditate with intensity in the form prescribed, he physically saw Bala Tripurasundari and he was able to hold her lotus feet tightly. And the book or the author writes, that is the next transformation, a stage of Savikalpa Samadhi. What do you mean by Savikalpa Samadhi? The known, and the process of knowing, if they stand apart, if they stand distinctly, but they are intertwined. Here is a case, Acharyal sits in meditation, he is engaged in the process of meditation, and he sees Bala Tripurasundari, whom he is able to hold. So all the three has happened. And body and surroundings get dissipated. It's not there. He's able to hold it. But still, all the three has not synchronized into one. Therefore, this samadhi is identified as Savikalpa Samadhi. That is the experience he is blessed with. Goes to the next evolved stage. As I said, it's slightly terse. Rest of these speeches, I have filled it with enough stories. Don't mistake me this time. I don't want, because we can't dilute it. Anyway, whatever is being shared is already in a diluted form. Because whatever occurs to my knowledge or understanding, I'm speaking from what is there in the book and what transpired as a matter of experience. But I don't want to dilute it further with any distraction. Because we should understand what is the process they undergo actually. So, he attains Savikalpa Samadhi. Then, so first stage, you consciously invoke the deity. Second stage, you start feeling the deity. Then the third stage, he writes beautifully, the book. He first sees Lord Krishna in this whole form, flute, with this mala, with this yellow garment, everything. Next day afternoon, he meditates. He sees Vishnu with eight arms. Evening, he sees Mahavishnu with just two arms and no ornaments. And the fourth phase, he sees Mahavishnu's face alone. When he meditates. So goes to Jagadguru, Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal, because he gets a doubt. Are we doing everything right, or is it a hallucination? The senior Acharya smiles at his Sishya, says, all right, you go and do your evening anika. Sends a book from Vishnu Puranam, flags a page, asks the attendant to deliver it to the Sishya for him to read. When Acharya opens that page and reads, it portrays, Vishnu Puranam portrays these four forms of meditative or contemplative postures. One after the other in sequence. And therefore, Acharyal confirms what you experience is not hallucination, it's a fact. So, he moves into the fourth stage, the pinnacle stage, I couldn't say pinnacle is bliss. He moves into the next stage of what we call it the Savikalpa Samadhi. And that chapter gets concluded by saying this. Why do you have to engage in deep meditation? You stand to benefit three. It purifies a person. That's the first point. Two, you are ensured abundant grace thereafter. Unlimited grace is an assurance to such people engaged in deep meditation. And three, it's the roadmap to take you further towards enlightenment. So, Hatha Yoga is over. Karma Yoga is over, contemplating the self is over, and Savikalpa Samadhi is also over. Now we go into the most critical phase, the experience of the Kundalini through the Kundalini Yoga, which is the jewel in this segment of this book, a jewel on the crown. Oh, what an experience. He would have enjoyed it. Acharyal was sitting one day in meditation. Absolute upsurge of joy and happiness. He was elated. He was in a stage of so much of an elation. Hears a feminine voice in Sanskrit. What happens? As he was in that stage of happiness, his body became transparent. That's exactly how it has been captured. His body becomes transparent, white, and he was able to see from a vantage point his very backbone in front of him. He says white, clear spinal cord, head from the top to bottom, white color. He is able to see it in front of him. And the female voice in Sanskrit shows three canals, one within the other, and voices out, this is Sushumna, this is Vajranadi, and this is Sitrinadi. Then moves to the next scene, finds breathing happens through his left nostrils, and the voice says, this is Ida, which gives you the cooling effect. After a while, sees breathing happening through his right nostrils. The voice says, this is Pingala, which gives you the heating effect. Then Acharyal says, he was able to see the six chakras in his spinal cord through his eyes. All the six chakras, starting from the Mooladhara. Where you find a small shivalinga, a shivalinga on the pericap, surrounded by a snake with 3.5 coils around it, and its hood just ensuring that the passage or the tubes to it is stuck. No flow. And in deep sleep. And the female voice identifies it in Sanskrit, this is Mooladhara. Shows the four letters of Sanskrit there, shows the divinities ruling it. In fact, people who are engaged in Sri Vidya Upasaka, where they'll first be initiated with the Mahaganapati mantra, because there is a theory that Mahaganapati loves her mother the most, because he is Gauri Nandan, Murugan is Shiva Balan. Therefore, his mother is considered to be Kundalini. So he is guarding his mother at the Mooladhara. And without his consent, mother will not step out to move forward. Is one theory. So he shows Muladhara, shows Swadhisthana, shows Manipura, shows Anahata, shows Vishuddha, shows Agna, and finally shows Sahasrara. And the voice says finally, this is the seat of Lord Parameshwara in Sanskrit. And he sees all the letters of Sanskrit, 15 number. And a 1,000 petal opening up. Sees it all by himself. And the voice keeps engaging in teaching him what it is all about. Slowly it moves up. Umeshji asks the question to Acharyal, how long did it take for you to undergo this process? Half an hour? 45 minutes? 1 hour? Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam laughs and says, sit down. Holds his feet, holds his hands tightly. And the author experiences whatever Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam has experienced without one process being left out. It's all in the book. Everything is in public domain. Therefore, I'm able to speak it freely and I have the consent to speak. Everything is in public domain. It's all there in the book. And he said, now find out how much time did it take? It started at 4:43 and it ended at 4:46, 3 minutes. So Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam said, all this I underwent in less than 5 minutes. Very important now. He goes to Acharyal to verify. Before that, the book says, Acharyal pats him on his cheek, like see we do to our children. The guru pats the Shishya on his cheek. Said, Sharadambal has been so gracious to you and she has taught you Kundalini Yoga. And did not stop there. He says, this is how she taught to my guru. And this is how she has taught to Vridhanarsimha Bharati, the 32nd Acharyal. And this is how Acharyals have been taught. And you have been blessed. He leaves himself out for a minute. That's what the author says. See his humility. See, they are all yogis sans ego. This is how I also got it. He didn't say. So the link has to be maintained because Chandrasekhahara Swamigal is a known established Jivan Muktha. So Umeshji takes one of the slokas composed by Chandrasekhahara Swamigal. And in that sloka, he has hinted how he has derived the same experience of Kundalini Yoga through Mata's grace and fills it up and says, this whole parampara, it has been the blessing of Sharadambal in initiating this unique great yoga of Kundalini. And says, you have got that experience today. Stay blessed. Acharyal goes to sleep that night. And in his dream, Sharadambal appears again, takes Acharyal on her lap, makes Acharyal sit on her lap, and a brahmachari emerges there. Sharadambal touches the muladhara of the brahmachari. The kundalini starts spiraling up. And it drops down. Sharadambal touches the agya, the guru sthanam, touches that, the kundalini starts rising up and comes down. And for the third time, Sharadambal just blesses the boy, the kundalini starts rising up. So, Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam says, I was taught by Sharadambal that these are the three sensitive points to invoke grace for the rising of Kundalini in a Shishya. Then moves to the next stage. he keeps practicing this Kundalini yoga on Tuesdays and Fridays. One fine day, as the Kundalini reaches the Sahasrara, he started to taste torrents of nectar into his throat. So cool, so tasty, so unique. Goes back to Acharya. Is this hallucination? Senior Jagadguru says, no, not at all. Not at all. Nothing but nectar. Goes back again. Sits into meditation. And this time finds Sharadambal sitting on his holy head in Sahasrara and pouring nectar torrentially from the top. Achalal writes, Sudha Sarabhi Varshini from the Lalita Sahasranam. One who pours torrents of nectar. Acharyal experiences it. Two things Jagadguru Chandrasekhahara Swami confirms. Two things. You cannot see the chakras through your naked eyes. It is a divine experience. Nor can you cut open your skull to find out whether there is any storage of nectar anywhere in the rear part of your brain. It pours. It pours out of divinity. Both are not tangible or visible. So don't try it. This is for us. You go to an X-ray, put all the best of scientific equipments, you can't find them. And he also utters a caution. Kundalini yoga should never be practiced without the guidance of a guru. If somebody attempts it on their own, three things are likely to occur. See, after all, we want to transform ourselves from an animal into a human being. Whereas, if you do it on your own without guidance, from what little human being you are, you will turn into a beast. It says, lust will be the first attack on that person who does it without guidance, followed by pain and sickness. If you do it with the guidance of your guru, you're free from these three evil maladies. Your journey is smooth and strong. So, now we have gone into the fifth stage, Kundalini Yoga. What is left out is just two more processes. A 2-minute diversion into Ramayana again. Because this is one question which throbs all of us all the while, and multiple interpretations are being given. When Vali is attacked by Rama, Vali doesn't die because he speaks to Rama. So Vali asks a question to Rama. After all, I'm a monkey. Why do you have to shoot it? You should have taken me one-on-one. And after all, you didn't kill me for the meat because Kshatriyas are prohibited from eating monkey's meat. And therefore, why did you not challenge me direct? So many people give so many versions to it. In fact, one of the popular versions is that in a social sense, see, you have to wage, he could have, Rama's gaiti is well known, he could have come and fought with Vali straight, in which case the rest of the Vanaras would have to get into the battlefield. Rama had to have destroyed 10,000 of them, which he needed their help to fight the war in Sri Lanka. So all these explanations are being given. Acharya gives one simple explanation to Vali. He says, oh Vali, you yourself admit you are a monkey. Tell me which dharma says for hunting an animal, you should go in front of the animal and put an engagement letter that I'm going to fight with you. Are you prepared for the war? We hunt deer. We hunt several animals. We'll hunt it from the back, from the front, from anywhere else. Now you admit you are a monkey. If so, where is the need for us, for me, to call you for an engagement and say I'll start shooting you direct? There's no need. And Rama is always a compassionate soul. He says, For all the sins you have committed, there are only two possibilities. The king should either punish you or the king should pardon you. Only then you can go to, I give death and kill all your sins so that you are free to pursue. That's a charity extend on you. This is something which Acharyal has said in one of the Anugraha Bhashanas, which is figuring. Now we'll come to the last two stage, the Savikalpa Samadhi of the formless, the Nirvikalpa Samadhi, and the attainment of Jivan Muktha. 10-15 minutes. We'll stick to our time schedule. One day, see, all this happens. One day, he walks out, as usual. He goes to Kalabhairava temple invariably for meditation. So Chandrasekhahara Swamigal calls for him. What are you planning for the day? Meditation. Oh, I see. Come here. He puts his holy hand on him. Om Namah Shivaya. So, Acharya thinks, today I will meditate on Shiva. Because this is the direction my guru has given. Sits into meditation, imagines the five-headed Shiva, 10 arms with Parvati, appears. As he keeps meditating, after all he has attained Savikalpa Samadhi, so he was able to hold the feet of Bala. Shiva appeared once again. That Shiva was in the dreams. This time Shiva appeared before him. Because he was able to materialize the state of Savikalpa Samadhi. And he describes in that book, oh, so graceful and kind he was. And Shiva speaks to him, child, from tomorrow you shall meditate on the formless. That's the blessing. Shiva directs that blessing. You shall meditate on the formless. The author writes, in his ecstasy and joy, in Bhujanga Prayatna meter, he puts in the 12th syllable, he puts a beautiful composition. It comes out of him, out of the joy. And two things happen. There is a light sunshine and there is a rainfall, which Acharya considered to be a fresh, pure bath in Ganges. Because when you see rain with sunlight, it is equivalent to bathing in Ganges. So he gets a bath in Ganges, sits again in the same place, and this time meditates on Dakshinamurti. After 1 hour of meditation, when he opens his eyes, he finds a cobra around his neck like a necklace. And the book says, the cobra was feeling so comfortable resting on the shoulders of Acharya. And the Acharya was feeling so comfortable that he was playing with the cobra. He pulled the cobra gently to his cheek and he started to wipe the cobra to his cheek. Gently. 5 long minutes it stayed with him on his shoulders and then went slowly out of him. All this happened at Kalabhairava temple. Now, Sishya Acharyal comes walking down to Narasimhavana. He was eager to report it to his guru, before which the guru blocked him. Please sit down. I think you had, he says two things. You had the special grace of Shiva today, is it so? Sishya says, yes. You have been given a divine direction to meditate on the formless, yes. And he finally says, you also enjoyed being a Bhujanga Bhushanan for a while. This happened in Kalabhairava temple. Senior Acharya is in Narasimhavana. And even before he describes what happened, he is talking to him. Now, he has been blessed to meditate on the formless. How does he do? See, 2 weeks were very important in the life history of Jyeshta Maha Sannidanam. 22nd May to 28th May 1931. 7 consecutive nights where Shiva appeared. Similarly, 5th December to 12th December 1935, the process of Savikalpa Samadhi of the Formless, Nirvikalpa Samadhi, and the attainment of a Jivan Muktha state happened in this 1 week. So the initiation to meditate on Shiva happens on 5th December, the first day. Then how does he meditate from tomorrow in the Formless? So, the book beautifully describes how he slowly eliminates to reach Brahmam is truth. It's a very big narration. After he has come to the conclusion to meditate on Brahmam, he hints how he did it. He said, "Let me allow Atma to be a witness to my thoughts." That is how he started to emerge, praying for the Formless. First thing, be a witness and disconnect your thoughts. And he says, what is the advantage? If you become a witness to your own thoughts, thoughts do not have fuel to run beyond a point. Because the fuel is you being part of it. You disassociate your thoughts from that and become a witness, thoughts will eventually die. And in this way, he started to slowly structure his worship on this Savikalpa Samadhi in the Formless. And narrates 2-3, when he started doing this, he continued to be only in Savikalpa Samadhi because these three, known, knower, and the process of knowing continued to be distinct. Continued to be distinct. Because he says rightly, I continue to feel enjoying it. I enjoy what I am doing. So that distinction still rested at that point of time. Now how to eliminate that? 3 things he did. He applied the same rationale of Advaita on a clay pot, on a sun, and on a wall in his prayer room. And Acharyal says, this is what he experienced. Sees a clay pot. Form and shape. You will be in Savikalpa Samadhi as long as you are associated with forms and shape. If you have to move to the next stage, you have to get over time, space, and objects. That's the process. How do you dissolve time, space, and objects? Seize a clay pot, disassociate the form. Seize a clay. Disassociate the name, find the materials with it, disassociate, keeps cracking it to the last and finally ends up by saying, this is nothing but Brahman manifesting in particular illusionary form. Takes the sun the next day, he sees the rays, he sees the effulgence, he sees the shape, starts eliminating one after the other. The third experience was looking at a wall. And Acharyal says, as I looked at the wall, it started disintegrating in front of me. Because name, form, shape, object, time, space started dissolving in front of me. I could just see only the presence of an illusion. And he describes it beautifully in that book. How do you get into this process? After all, when you go into a desert, you see a mirage. Thinking that it is a water pond. But when you move out of particular radius and sees it from a different perspective, you find it out it's only a mirage and not a water pond. When you stay tuned in a Savikalpa Samadhi of the Formless, you will get this experience very frequently. You will be able to see something as illusory at that moment. When you come out of it, it will become part of it. So this was the experience he was undergoing with various things. Now, because it is 12th December, we are now closer to 10th. Just 2 days left out. He progresses to the next stage of Nirvikalpa Samadhi. By cracking all these one after the other and realizing that it is only Brahman, he ends up finally in his contemplative abilities. He is able to dissolve the distinction between the knower, the known, and the process of knowing. It starts to crack down. It just starts to crack down. So he reaches the stage of Nirvikalpa Samadhi by 10th and repeats this cycle 4 or 5 times. On 12th December 1935, he goes to the Kala Bhairava temple at 4:30 in the evening, sits into meditation and jerks straight away into Nirvikalpa Samadhi and says, traces of dissolution, left out dissolution, gets dissolved that moment. It's like salt getting dissolved into water. And what do you separate after that dissolution? On 12th December 1935, he started his journey on 22nd May 1931, 4.5 years, hardly 50 months, 54 months, undergoes all these 6 stages and enters the blissful state of a Jivan Muktha on 12th December 1935 evening. He finds 2 birds sitting over him, goes into meditation, finds a monkey playing with him, goes into meditation, and finally emerges out to the state of Jivan Muktha. And the book describes him, how he was at that time. He was weighing like a cotton wool, says the book. And when he walked down from the hill, it was like a canoe moving slowly. A canoe is called a weightless boat. When he walked towards Narasimhavana, Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamigal is waiting at the entrance of Sachidananda Vilas to receive his sishya, the Jivan Muktha. And the book says, he starts chanting from Mundaka Upanishad, from Viveka Chutamani, from Bhagavad Gita, verses in praise of a Brahmajnani. And the Acharyal falls at the lotus feet of his guru and holds it. Says, go and follow your Anika. 2 days, he starts into this frequent cycles of staying in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. And one incident happens. With that, we can possibly close today's session. One night, two, three days after he attained the Jivan Mukta state, he went into such a deep meditation of Nirvikalpa Samadhi. After a while, he saw his senior Jagadguru sitting by his side and patting him on his shoulders to wake him up. And this is the conversation that happens. Acharyal wakes up and sees his guru, falls at his feet. And Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal says to Jagadguru Srimad Abhinava Vidyatirtha the following: Lord Shiva sent me here to get you out of this samadhi. I was cautioned, if you allow your sishya to stay in this samadhi, he will become irretrievable thereafter, till he throws his mortar coil out. And Acharyal says, don't leave me. That's what the book says. Don't leave me. Don't leave this Peetam. Don't leave your Sishyas. You have a lot of things to do. And therefore, that prompted me to wake you up. This is the stage which he could attain at the age of 18. Because he was born in 1917 and he attained this state in December 1935, exactly 18 years and 1 month. Let me close today's talk with just a 5-minute narration. I was very particular that I portray about, when I portray this process about Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, I have always been referring to every author, every textbook in all the earlier speeches. So I had to talk to someone to take a consent whether am I permitted to refer his name and about him and his experiences. The reply I got was, what is this experience I got? It's like somebody having a torch. He can choose to show it in object A or object B or object C. And that's the way he showed it on me. And therefore, where is the need for a reference? This was the answer I got. But I was not happy. I went into the book again to find out, is it simply putting a torch indiscriminately on some objects? No. There are at least 3 or 4 instances which is so unique. I do not know whether a second Sishya had such a similar experience which Sri Umesh ji got with Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, which is also forming part of the book as published. One was when he attained the Kundalini Yoga experience which I narrated. He just clasped his hands and Sri Umesh ji was able to attain whatever experience Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam can attain. And to say it was a torch shown by Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam on him in a very casual way, Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam replies it to Umesh ji in the same book at page 322. He says, Shaktipada is an energy which a guru can choose to transform or transfer into a Sishya. Whatever he has, he can transfer it to his Sishya. It is possible. But a guru cannot use it indiscriminately on everyone. Deserving alone gets Shaktipada. The second experience is, when Sri Umesh ji was practicing Nirvikalpa Samadhi, he had some doubts. So Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam was so compassionate. He said, let's both try it out together. So it was a dialogue of Nirvikalpa Samadhi. He says, you try this, I will also try this, let's meet tomorrow. So when Umesh ji narrates, this is my first step, then Acharya says, is this the second step? Is this the third step? Is this the fourth step? They keep discussing the steps one after the other. The second experience which he was benefited with. And the third experience was, when he was traveling in Kundapura, he was sitting in a different car and Acharya's attendant Mahabala was sitting along with him in his car. He requested Mahabala to go and get into the other car and invite Sri Umesh ji to come here. And Umesh ji sat in the car of Mahasannidhanam and he writes, he transformed the benefits of Atma Anusantanam by his grace, by his love, by his kindness to me. It was, he puts it in his word, the experience was tremendous. So, these are the 3 experiences which he could give it to him. And maybe these are all in public domain, much more. But I was very clearly asked to say one mention very importantly, when I say the reference to Sri Umesh ji, he said, what is most important is this. Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam had attained all these experiences one after the other. This has been captured in a book by talking to him at several points of time. But somebody to certify or authenticate this is true and valid, it could be done only by his Sishya, because this parampara carries one from the other. Only his Sishya can authenticate. And Mahasannidanam was gracious to authenticate all that is figuring in this book as truth. And this should be mentioned clearly. So it is in this process, these vital secrets have come out for the first time in public domain. And let's understand it. This was never revealed in the lifetime of Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam. It happened only after that. So things will never get revealed in the lifetime of Mahasannidhanam. Things will never get revealed in the lifetime of Sannidhanam. In fact, the only experience after 44 years, Mahasannidhanam shared it in public domain last year as a part of the 100-year celebration of centenary celebration of Abhinava Vidyatirtha was. He said, on the day of my sannyasam, when I went to bed that night, I had a dream where, starting from the 32nd Acharyal, Vridhanasva Bharati Swamigal, Sachidananda Narasimha Bharati Swamigal, Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal, and Abhinava Vidyatirtha Mahaswamigal, all the four were seated in their peetams. And I had the divine opportunity of going and prostrating before each one of them and came and sat. I narrated this experience that night, which I had on the day of sannyasam, to Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam. He said, This is a good sign and a symptom for you to progress in this place. One incident in 44 years, he just dropped it into public domain. We will not get it in his lifetime. Therefore, the message which we should carry is, this avichinna guru parampara, only forms and periods will keep changing. The underlying current, what he said, in fact, Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam says, when you attain Jivan Muktha, how did you feel? He said, I am now seeing everything as merely as bubbles in an ocean. I see everything as bubbles in an ocean. And I see those bubbles are nothing but illusions. That's exactly how he portrays his state. And Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal says, every one of the acharyas in this peetam attains this experience. And therefore, whenever we go there to offer our prayers and worship, let's do this keeping in mind with utmost reverence and bhakti that what we offer is not a human form, but a divine form in an elated, enlightened state of a Jivan Mukta. The whole 1.5 hours lecture, the attempt was only to reach to that and not anything else. We will see tomorrow, same 6 o'clock. It won't be terse. It's going to be more on when he attained Jivan Mukta at 18 and he would have gone into an irretrievable phase. He was retrieved to the Peetam and he adorned the Peetam and ran it for 55 long years till he threw his mortal coil at 73. And what did he do in this 55 years? As an administrator, with a child, what did he do? Incidences with children, instances with helpless devotees, instances with Christians, instances with Muslims, instances with atheists, and how an atheist leader respects Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, and how a Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam respects an atheist leader. It's there in the book, a beautiful episode. It is only followers who fight, not leaders. It's very clear. So we will be narrating all these events and incidents tomorrow. I took 10 extra minutes today, but pardon me for that. Tomorrow, sharp 6 o'clock. Vivekinam mahapragyam dairodha rachamanidim sadabhinavapurvantam vidyatirtha gurumbache. I praise all the offerings and thoughts and expressions at the lotus feet of Jyeshta Mahasannidhanam, Mahasannidhanam and Sannidhanam. Thank you so much.